Sunday of Epiphany. Today marks the transition from gold, frankincense, and myrrh to the soot and smudge of ashes. Today we pack up the wise men that have surrounded us these past weeks, reminding us that Christ came into the world for all people. And we prepare ourselves to observe a holy Lent. We get ready for a time of self-reflection and for particular and intentional alignment with the Son of God and His sacrifice for God's beloved. On the final Sunday of Epiphany, it is the church's tradition to read the lessons of Jesus' transfiguration. Every year at this time, we hear the story. Jesus has been on the move. He's been baptized in the Jordan River. He's been starving in the wilderness. He's been tempted by the devil. He's been calling disciples. He's been preaching on the mount and on the plain, curing the lame and the lepers, drawing crowds, drawing haters, becoming known as a force to be reckoned with. And now, he takes a break. He takes a pause. 6 days after a heated confrontation with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, 6 days after Jesus pushes his disciple to declare who it is they think he is, 6 days after Peter stakes the claim, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." 6 days after Jesus tells his 12 chosen that he must now turn his face towards Jerusalem to go stand before the elders and the chief priests and the scribes to be killed and to be raised. 6 days after all this exhaustive work, Jesus takes a break. He asks Peter and James and John to go with him. He leaves the crowd, the spies, the curious, the sick, the broken, the other disciples, and begins a climb up Mount Tabor. It's not a great peak, but it will get you winded. At the summit, they stop. Jesus intends to be still, to be quiet, to be in prayer. And in the still, and in the quiet, and in the prayer, something strange, something mysterious, something miraculous happens. Jesus is changed. He is transfigured. His appearance is decidedly altered. And two other figures appear. Figures clearly recognized as Moses and Elijah. And Jesus is calm. And he is not agitated by his dazzling, altered transformation. And he is not alarmed by the appearance of these figures. James and John are silent and nervous. Peter is impatient. and impertinent. And as usual, he launches forward with an impulsive plan. A voice from heaven speaks. The three disciples tremble and fall to the ground. They feel physically sick. Jesus speaks. They look up. The figures, Moses and Elijah, are gone. The voice, the cloud, are gone. The four men turn away and begin their descent down the mountain. They start their return to the other nine disciples. They start their return to the next day's schedule. They start their return to the trek on to Jerusalem. They start their return to all the teaching and healing and preaching and transformations and betrayal and trials and pain and danger and anointing and saving and arising that await them. And so the account of the Transfiguration ends. And usually the biblical commentary and the sermon addresses this being the pivotal point of Jesus' ministry. This event clarifies, testifies, authenticates Jesus' identity. He is God's Son. He is God's beloved Son. Listen to him. He is the mouthpiece of God. He surpasses Moses. He surpasses the law. He surpasses Elijah. He is greater than the greatest prophet that ever was. The one true living God has exalted Jesus above all other authorities. On this mountain, God has made Jesus the connecting point between the temporal and the eternal. And here on this summit, in this thin air, and in quiet, and in prayer, in dazzling light and heavenly voice, the trajectory of Jesus' life and human redemption changes forever. And all this important theology is what is generally studied on Transfiguration Sunday. But all week long, as I read this passage, the lines I couldn't forget was, when the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." Beloved, what does it mean? What does it mean that the first thing Jesus does after the skies open up and the voice of God declares, "You are my son. You carry my divine DNA. You are greater than the law. You are greater than the prophets." The first response is to come so close, reach down, take hold of the three humans, lift them up, speak softly to them, "Get up. I've got you. Don't be afraid. I'm here. I'm right here for you always." What does it mean? What does it mean about the nature of God that at the moment of his revelation, his ultimate disclosure, the unveiling of his Godhead, he is intimately, intimately connecting and comforting humans in those initial moments. There is no discussion of sacrifices or sacraments. There is no discussion of offerings or rituals. There's no discussion of guilt or sin or obligation. First moment, first thing Jesus Christ, Jesus the Christ does after his ultimate revelation, the initiation of his Godhead, is to offer touch, assurance, lift, and confidence. Knowing what comes next, once they are off that mountain, the testing and the traps and the betrayal and the trial and the torture and the death, what does it mean that the Lord's first priority is touch, assurance, lift, and promise? Dear ones, think on this. In that moment and all subsequent moments, that is who Christ Jesus is. When your beloved has left this earth and you are bereft, wondering if you'll ever smile again, Jesus has already come close. Jesus has already come close, touched you, has aligned with you, has already grasped your forearm, is pulling you up and saying, "Do not fear. There is still joy to be found in your life. I am with you in the finding of it." When you have three college acceptances and don't know which one to pick or who to choose as your roommate or what major to declare, Jesus has already taken hold of you, saying, "Be not afraid. I am lifting you up. I am with you in the unpacking of it all." When you are facing retirement and don't know if your finances will last or where you will find purpose, Jesus is already there. You don't have to search for, grasp about. He's already lifting you up, saying, "Be not afraid. I am with you in the discovery." When the girl you like doesn't like you now or anymore, Jesus is already there lifting you up, saying, "Joy will be found in your life. I promise, I am here with you." When your body is not supporting you and your mind leaves you bewildered, Jesus says, "So, beloved, this Lent,